Greetings, friends, and welcome to another edition of In the Scriptures, where we explore a variety of topics from the Bible and their significance to the time they are written in, and more importantly, their significance for us today. I'm Craig Fish, and I hope that our time together will be as much a blessing for you as it is for me. When was the last time that you were in desperate need of help? Or when was the last time that someone showed up to help you out of a situation that you were not able to get out of by yourself? Did you express your gratitude to that person? Most of the time, we as people try to be as self-sufficient as possible, but this doesn't always work out. Sometimes, we need a little help. Not only did Jesus say that he would never leave us nor forsake us, he promised to be with us to the end. That promise was extended to those that choose to continually follow after him. This promise can also be found at the end of the Gospel of Matthew. Now, to be fair, we also have to recognize the fact that this promise can and has been misapplied. An example of this kind of thinking that God is always with a certain kind of people no matter what, is in what we're going to look at today. The Jewish people were under Roman rule, and they hated it. They were looking for their liberator, the Messiah. They were looking for someone that would come and set them free from the bondage to Rome, just like God did before from the Egyptians with Moses. Many of the people saw in Jesus the possibility of this happening. They heard and or even saw the plethora of miracles that he had been doing, giving or restoring sight to the blind, feeding huge crowds from almost nothing, healing the sick and the lame, and even raising the dead back to life. Many of them thought, surely this is the one that can and will lead us to victory over the Romans. And while Jesus came to lead his people to victory, it was a different kind of victory than what they were looking for. Jesus came to provide the way of victory over sin and death. He did this so that he could eventually set up the glorious kingdom of God and to erase sin from existence so that complete freedom from oppression can and will happen. But first, the power of the curse of sin had to be broken, the power of death. This is the true bondage that we all face now. Should time march on long enough, each and every one of us will, as both Joshua and King David once said, go the way of all the earth, that is, die and be buried. But Christ came that this reality that we all know will be broken and eternal life will reign instead. But the Jewish people, or any people for that matter, were not looking for this kind of a victory when Jesus came and walked upon the earth. They were looking primarily for an earthly kingdom that would place them at the top of all other people groups. God had actually made some promises that led the people to hold this idea, but they were misunderstood, and those promises were misapplied, and they ignored the fact that sin had to be overcome first before the kingdom of God could come and be set up on earth and righteousness reign forever. Well, in this edition of In the Scriptures, we're going to see Jesus make an arrival into Jerusalem in a way that makes the people think their hopes and dreams of liberation are at hand, and many of the people reacted jubilantly. And in truth, many of their dreams were being fulfilled, just not in the way that they were looking for. Jesus came to first deal with the root of the problem before the blessings of eternal life could be made possible. He came to deal with the real need, before the desire of ages could be made real. And what is that desire of the ages? Life and peace with God and our fellow man. As always, when our study time is completed, we will come back here for some additional thoughts and closing remarks. So let's go ahead and step right into our study that comes to us from John chapter 12, verses 12 through 36, a study entitled Hosanna. So the last time we were together, we began exploring John chapter 12. And the first, eight verses or so, we can go as far as the first 11 verses. There's the story of the anointing that Jesus receives. This is where Mary Magdalene comes in. She breaks this alabaster vase and pours this ointment of spikenard on Jesus' feet and anoints him. And there's this contention that arises. Of course, Judas Iscariot says, oh, why was this wasted like this? This could have been sold and given to the poor. Of course, if you think about that, here's this guy thinking that this lady has just wasted expensive perfume on his master. What does that say about what he truly thinks of his master? Of course, Lazarus is there at the table as well. And we can gather quite succinctly that, as we're going to see today, they have come together. They are preparing to go off to Jerusalem for the Passover, and they're having a meal together before they go off on this trip to Jerusalem. And so they have gathered. There are people who have come because they've heard about this whole thing that happened with Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead. This ends up becoming a very key miracle through the rest of the Gospel of John, and we're even going to see some of it today as well. But of course, as we will also see, there are those who didn't like what Jesus was doing. Of course, this is the final week of Jesus' life on this earth. This is the week that he is going to be crucified here at the Passover. And they want to get Jesus out of the way. But of course, there is this notable, irrefutable miracle of raising Lazarus from the dead, who was somebody who was as dead can possibly be, not only biologically, physiologically, but also according to tradition. If somebody had been dead for 4 days, there was nothing at all that could be done for that person. Of course, in many cases, if you're dead for a day, there's nothing that can be done for you either. But according to tradition, the whole idea is that after 4 days, the soul, the spirit, has definitely departed from this dead body. There is no life that can in any way, shape, or form ever possibly come back to this person. And Jesus said, no, I'm going to change that. And I'm going to show you that I have the power over death. And that's exactly what Jesus does, is he resurrects Lazarus from the dead. So what does this do? But we have these religious leaders who are saying, now it's not just enough to get rid of Jesus. No, we got to get rid of him too. This guy Lazarus that he raised from the dead. Because that is a glaring example of our error and his superiority to us. We can't have that. So we got to get rid of him too. But this miracle that everybody has heard about has drawn quite the crowd. In fact, as verse 12 tells us, this is the day now after that anointing of Jesus' feet at that dinner. There is a crowd that has gathered, and they're all traveling to Jerusalem for this coming feast. But here we have, and of course now the Gospel of John doesn't tell us necessarily all of these details. The other Gospel accounts fill in some of these blanks that John leaves out. But Jesus tells some of his disciples, go ahead of us. You're going to find a donkey who is tied up and bring it to me. And if anybody asks you, what are you doing? Just tell them that the master has need of it and everything will be fine. And sure enough, just as Jesus said, two of his disciples go, they find a colt, they untie it. And somebody said, hey, what are you doing? Have you ever thought about that short little tiny snippet of this story? And we don't know who this guy was. There's no names given to us for who it was that owned this colt. But simply the fact that the disciples said that the master has need of it. Imagine if that was your colt and somebody says the master has need of it. How many of you would say, oh, okay, go right ahead then? Well, what master is he talking about? Obviously, this is somebody who had to have heard of Christ, who felt that Jesus was the Messiah, heard his teachings, perhaps witnessed miracles. We don't really know who this man was, but the fact that the disciples only had to say, the master has need of it, and this person was so willing to just let this colt go, shows that he had to have some inclination of who this man Jesus was. And sure enough, now they bring the colt to Jesus. And the Bible tells us that they lay coats over it, over the animal. And Jesus gets up on the animal. And now something really extraordinary starts to happen. We have, and Lazarus is, of course, with this group. They're all there together. Here's Jesus, the guy who raised Lazarus from the dead. Here's Lazarus, the guy who was raised from the dead. And he's riding on a colt. Well, this is a pretty extraordinary scene right here. This is nothing to bat an eye at. Jesus is actually following a very
hard-lined Jewish tradition of a king, how they have a royal entry into Jerusalem by riding on a colt. An animal that has never been ridden before. This is a person that's what a king would ride. You'd think, why would a king ride a little colt? Wouldn't you want something more majestic, like this big white stallion or something that's got all these rippling muscles and has this high step to its trot and all that kind of stuff? But no, that's not what they do. Instead, they use a colt, something that has never been ridden before. That is what a king rides in on. And look what happens in verse 13. The people took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him and cried out, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel." Now, there are a few things that we need to really pay attention to here. First of all, what is the festival that they have all gathered for? They've gathered for the Passover. What does the Passover point back to? Exodus, that's right. The breaking of the bondage of slavery to the Egyptians. What is it that the Jews are looking for at this time, in the time of Christ? They're looking for another liberation, right? Liberation now from the Romans. So how fitting is it here at the Passover, which points back to their liberation from Egypt, that now Jesus, this man that they have all seen do these tremendous miracles, that so many people have heard these stories, despite the fact that Jesus says, "Shh, don't tell anybody that what I've just done for you." They go and they tell. Now, you really can't blame anybody for that. I mean, if you were a cripple for 50 years and somebody just spoke a word and you could stand up and walk and run, maybe start running marathons all over again, I think you would tell somebody. And if you didn't tell somebody, other people would say, what happened to you? There is no getting around these things. The miracles, the stories spread. Everybody has come to know who this guy Jesus is. Here it is now on the Passover, an anniversary of the liberation from Egypt. And now here's this guy telling all these stories have been told about, all these miracles that he has done, and he is following the tradition of a royal entry into Jerusalem. And everybody who has been waiting for their Messiah. You know, there's a lot more people than you might think who study the scriptures, and they know that this is around about the time that the Messiah needs to be showing up. And they're thinking, this is it. Of course, they have a little confusion as far as what exactly the Messiah is and how he is supposed to liberate them. But here he is following these traditions. It's the anniversary of their liberation from Egypt, and here he is riding into Jerusalem in the way that a king has a royal entry into Jerusalem, and the excitement is enormous. And so there was a time when I looked at that word Hosanna, and I have to say, I wondered really what that was. What exactly does the word Hosanna mean? So I did some digging and some searching around, and it turns out that, of course, you know, the Gospel of John is written in Greek, but Hosanna is not a Greek word. It's actually a Hebrew word. There is no really Greek equivalent for it. So what they did from the Hebrew language is they just took the word Hosanna and transliterated it. They took the same letters from Greek that make those same sounds and plugged them in to turn it into a Greek word. So it's actually a Hebrew word. But you know what the word means? Think of it like this. Let's say you're out on a boat, and it's a good sized boat. But even big boats can tip over. So let's say you're on this good-sized boat, and it tips over, and you're stuck in the water. So if you were thinking of a Hebrew mind, and you're wanting to cry out for help, you would say, "Hosanna! Help me!" Okay? But along the way, this word Hosanna, at least according to some scholars, that it gained an additional meaning. I question this a little bit, but it gained an additional meaning to say that then somebody else comes along in another boat, and they grab one of those lifesavers with the rope attached to it, and they throw it out to you, and you stick your arm through it and put it over your head so you don't fall out of it, and they pull you into their boat. Then when you get onto their boat, you say Hosanna again, because now the first was a cry for help to come. The second is now a cry that help has come. So both instances, the word Hosanna is used very appropriately so. there is this dual application that has been applied to this word over time. In fact, the first time we actually see the word Hosanna used in the Old Testament, it's in the context of help has arrived. Now, I actually wonder if this word didn't kind of always have this dual meaning to it. We have examples of that today. You go to Hawaii, I've never been there myself, but if you go to Hawaii, they have the word aloha, which can both mean hello and goodbye. You go to Jerusalem, they have the word shalom, which can be both hello and goodbye. So words have dual meanings in many cases, and there's really no reason for us to think that Hosanna hasn't kind of always had this dual meaning having to do with please help and thank you that help has arrived. But whatever the history of that word is, it's something that the people very much understood what it is that they were saying. They were praising God. Here it is that this Jesus is coming into Jerusalem with a royal entry on this colt, and they're saying, thank you, salvation, help has arrived, and here he is. But this isn't something where they're just saying it one time. In fact, I want everybody to take a moment and just say Hosanna. Hosanna. One more time, a little bit louder.
Hosanna.
Very good. One more time, a little louder. Hosanna! Now imagine that. There's these coats that are being laid down, these palm branches that are being laid down, and there's this cry. One more time. Hosanna! One more time. Hosanna! There's great mass of people who are saying this, and you know, it's getting some attention, by the way. How do we know that? Verse 16, his disciples did not understand these things at first. But when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things were written about him and that they had done these things to him. Now, of course, that's something that we should really keep in mind. When this stuff is happening, the disciples, they're caught up in the moment of this as well. And they're still having some of this incorrect perception of who and what the Messiah is. They're thinking the same thing that everybody else is thinking. That he is going to liberate the Jewish people from the Romans. He's going to set them on top of everything once again. And they're going to be the people who rule all over everywhere. And especially, more importantly, they rule themselves. But after Jesus is glorified, which of course comes after the resurrection, they remembered. And the word there is actually in a passive form. So it's not like they were deliberately trying to sit there and concentrate and think about all this stuff that was happening. But rather, it's almost like it was brought back to their memory. You ever had a moment like that where you're doing something and just a memory from the past pops into your head? And perhaps there's, I wonder why that happened. Maybe after all these years later, as I think about this event, maybe that happened because of this. But yet in the moment, you didn't necessarily recognize why it was happening. But after the fact, you have a little bit deeper insight. That's kind of what was happening with the disciples later on as this stuff would come to their memory, and they would have a deeper and longer lasting impression of all of these events that were happening. Therefore, the people who were with him when he called Lazarus out of the tomb and raised him from the dead bore witness. So again, this whole idea of Lazarus having been raised from the dead is still very prevalent in everybody's mind. And he's there. People are focused on this point. This was nothing for them to ignore. For this reason, what was the reason? Verse 17 just told us what the reason was. Raising Lazarus from the dead. For this reason, the people also met him. Who's the him? They're talking about Jesus. Because they heard that he had done this sign. What was that sign? Raising Lazarus from the dead. So, you know, we tend to sometimes read a gospel account and rifle past something and think that, well, it's locked into that story. It's on the pages of Scripture. But we don't necessarily always think that the minds of the people are continuing to bring this up and to think about this and to remember these different things. I don't see why we'd have to do that. We do the exact same thing ourselves all the time. When something happens in our own past, we remember it. Some of us try to forget, but most of the time we remember what it is that we have done in the past. The Pharisees, therefore, said among themselves, "You see that you are accomplishing nothing. Look! The whole world has gone after him. So how do the Pharisees now come into this story? Why are they so interested? Well, what is it that the people are doing? They're calling him the Messiah. There's a shout of Hosanna. This is a noise that cannot be ignored. And the Pharisees, who have been trying to get him out of the way because they feel that Jesus is stealing their influence, and they are the ones who are losing control, are trying to step in and squelch this little bit of noise because they don't like what is happening. And incidentally, the English language doesn't really have this so much. Some of you might have an exclamation mark at the end of verse 19, and that, kind of gives us an idea of how to understand this. But within the Greek language and even the Hebrew language, there are things that are written into the words that can kind of tell us where the point of emphasis is when they are speaking. And one of those is in the word "you see." It's written in what's called an imperative form. So you can kind of think of it as them saying, "You see? You're doing nothing! All this work that you've been trying to do to get rid of his influence, and look what they're doing! They're calling him the Messiah! They're saying Hosanna over this guy! What good is all your effort?" That's essentially what they are doing amongst themselves. They're very displeased with how it is that this guy from Galilee is getting all this attention. And the people are flocking after him rather than paying attention to them, the priests. All the world has gone after him. Now, the next verse really tells us what truly happens when God moves. Jesus came, and for all this time, 3.5 years now, he has been amongst the Jewish people, ministering to the Jewish people, addressing their needs. But just like he's doing various miracles and saying, "Shh, don't tell anybody," word still gets out. All these people who are coming to Jerusalem, the vast majority of them are Jews who have come for the Passover, but it's not limited to the Jews. Word has gotten out past the Jewish circles. Now there were certain Greeks among those who came up to worship at the feast. Then they came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida of Galilee, and asked him, saying, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip came and told Andrew, and then in turn Andrew and Philip told Jesus. Now, why would these Greeks want to see Jesus? How'd they hear about it? Well, it's simple. People talk. Word gets out. When the power of God moves, there is no containing it. If you recall from earlier in the Gospel of John, he's talking to the woman at the well about a fountain of living water. The whole idea of living water is that it's water that flows. There is no way to stop it. You can build as high of a dam as you want. It will overflow whatever barrier you can put in it. There's no stopping living water. And the living water that is Christ spilled over into the lives of people, and other people who may not necessarily have been Jewish of origin heard what was going on. There are people who were devout. They studied the scriptures. In fact, we see examples in the book of Acts of people who were not Jewish who studied the scriptures, and they were hearing about this guy Jesus, and they wanted to know more. These Greeks are no exception. They wanted to know more about what it was that this whole hubbub is about this guy Jesus. They wanted to go and ask him. Perhaps we don't really know what questions they wanted to ask because there is no dialogue recorded of what it is that they actually talk about. But what we do see is Jesus' response to their request. But Jesus answered them, saying, "The hour has come that the Son of Man should be glorified." Why is he saying that the hour has come that the Son of Man should be glorified? It's very simple. Because word has gotten out. It's just that simple. Word has gotten out that Jesus is powerful. And these people who are not of Jewish origin, they want to get to know him as well. "Most assuredly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it produces much grain." So now, I'm sure that most of you have heard the analogies before about how in agriculture, When you create a when you harvest a field, you keep a little bit of that harvest back so you have seed for the next year. And then that seed, you eat the rest, do whatever, whether you grind it up, whatever, eat it, sell it, whatever it is that you're going to do, but you hold back a portion so that you have seed for the following year. That seed then goes into the ground, it dies, and in that process of dying is where new life comes from that seed. It's very interesting how it is that these things happen. I don't know if this is still the case, but I remember not too terribly long ago that I was listening to some guy talk about some biological things, and he's even talking about a child when that embryo begins to grow. We can nail down everything that's happening, that very moment that life starts to happen. We can tell you when, but we really can't tell you why it happens. We can't look at these things and say this. We know that when these things come together, this is what happens. But we can't necessarily tell you why it happens that way. Just like we can't necessarily tell you when a seed dies, from its death, life comes. We can nail down all the steps of the process, but we can't really tell you exactly why it works this way. And it works that way because God deemed for it to work that way. There are mysteries that he retains from us so that we can, by faith, follow him. Not necessarily with all of our questions answered. Because if we won't follow God unless we have all of our questions answered, that's not faith. And so what is it that Jesus is referring to here about this seed falling into the ground and dying, but he's referring to his own death that's about to happen within a few days from now, and what that death of himself would bring, but life eternal for everybody else who desires to cling to it. But Jesus continues on here. He who loves his life will lose it, and he who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Now, there's some interesting contrasts between verses 24 and 25. First off, we have this whole idea of the seed falling in the ground and dying, contrasted with producing life. We also have this contrast of one who loves his life is one who loses his life, and one who hates his life is the one who preserves his life. Now, we have to understand that when Jesus is saying he who hates his life is not referring to somebody saying, "Ooh, I just hate myself." That's not what that's talking about. It's a set of priority is really what Jesus is talking about. It's placing others ahead of yourself. The one who basically lives life for self, well, they're going to have their reward, and it's in this life, and that's as far as it's going to go. There is nothing more to come for them. In the exact same way that Jesus talks about the religious leaders who would go out and make these big, loud prayers, and they put their arms out, and they have these robes and these things hanging down so that people can see them and hear them making these prayers, "Oh, Lord," and they do, they do this thing, "Oh," like that, and people watch, and they look, and, "Oh, how holy he must be that he prays in such ways." That is their reward. That's as far as it goes, is somebody saying how holy they must be. That's it. But what about the person that Jesus says won't even look up to the sky but beats their chest? "Forgive me, a sinner." Because why? They recognize who and what they really are. That they're messed up and that there is no hope for them outside of the blood of Christ. "If anyone serves me, let him follow me. And where I am, there my servant will be also. If anyone serves me, him my Father will honor." So what can we glean from verse 26? "If anyone serves me, let him follow after me. And where I am, there my servant is also." Does it say where my servant is, there I am also? No. What does it say? Where I am. So who's there first? Jesus is there first. I know that there are some of you who do this, but when was the last time that you prayed, "Lord, give me a divine intervention, a divine interaction today. Let me connect with somebody at some level where we can deliberately have a spiritual conversation." When was the last time you prayed for that? And I'm not trying to chastise anybody for having not done it for a while, but it's good to get into that habit. Because by the time you come in contact with somebody, guess what? God's already there. He's there ahead of you. He's been preparing the way for that before you ever even thought of that prayer. There was an experience that I had. I was out doing some door knocking. This was in Albany, New York. I was working as a Bible worker at the time. And, you know, that's a very frustrating job. You work on, you knock on doors, you talk to people, you're trying to generate interest in Bible studies, and the overwhelmingly vast majority of people say no every single time. It's just the way it is. It doesn't matter where you are, that's just the way it is. I get a kick out of when we say, man, it's just tough to do evangelism around here. Guess what? It's tough to do evangelism everywhere. That's just the nature of the beast. It's tough to do evangelism for a multitude of reasons that I'm not going to get into right now because I don't want to get too terribly sidetracked. But I remember knocking on this one door, and this lady opened the door, and I start talking to her. You know, I can be a pretty pleasant guy most of the time. And so I start talking with her, and she's engaging with me. And I had a clipboard that I was doing surveys, you know, spiritual interest surveys and so on. That, in fact, there's actually research that was released here not too terribly long ago, a few years back, you know, rating the I'm trying to think of how it's the spirituality of various cities across the country in contrast to the lack of spirituality in these various countries. Well, this was part of that research that was being conducted, and you know, interestingly enough, come to find out that the city of Albany, where I was doing this Bible work, was ranked A1 on the top of the list for the least spiritual city in the country. And I started to think, that explains a few things. But at any rate, here I am. I have this clipboard, and on this clipboard, I have this sheet that I'm filling things out. I just happen to have this little thing from Amazing Facts that happened to be poking out from under the sheet. And the lady looked down, and she saw that emblem of Amazing Facts. And I didn't necessarily know why, but I caught this moment where her eyes lightened up, and she just, like, the guard was gone. And she just was more than happy to talk to me all day long if I wanted to have that kind of a conversation with her. We set up Bible studies, and probably about our third or fourth lesson, we got into a little bit of a conversation. Now, she worked in an area that I don't really want to get too terribly detailed on, but it consists of the nightlife. I'll leave it at that. But years ago, when she was much younger, she had this burning question because there were some events that had happened. She knew of some families that had lost little children. And she was really just torn up. What happens to these little children? How can this God be so, how is he so loving and so merciful when these little babies are dying? And this was really tearing her up inside. And she just happens to turn on television to a station that she's not normally watching, and there's Amazing Facts, Doug Batchelor, talking about what happens when you die. And it answered her questions. And now here, 30 years later, she encounters me with this little Amazing Facts thing sticking out from under a piece of paper, and the Amazing Facts stuck in her mind. The bald guy stuck in her mind, you know, Doug Batchelor. She remembered that. And then she saw that very same emblem on that piece of paper right there, and it just opened up the way for us to engage in Bible studies and go through a whole series. Now, the interaction that I was having with her had absolutely nothing to do with me. Anybody else could have been standing there doing the exact same thing. But it was the work that God was doing in her life. Despite the fact that she was working in an area of life that most of us would consider deplorable and disgusting, God still reached out to her in that moment. All these years later, the seeds that were planted way back then were starting to come to flourish when she was at a point where she was ready to actually learn more. Did God force the issue? No, he didn't. He worked with her where she was, when she was ready, as she was capable. The question is, what would have happened if I had decided, you know, maybe I'll just ignore that door today. Sure, she could have had an encounter with somebody else. I'm not going to deny that. But what if, say, I decided, you know, today I'm just going to stay home. You know, I've knocked on what seems like 20,000 doors in the past couple of months, and this is really getting nowhere. I might as well just, you know, take a day off, get a little breather, relax a little bit. She still could have had that encounter with somebody else at some other point in time. But it wasn't just her that she was working on. I was being worked on as well. Why? Because I needed to see how God works in somebody's life all those years ago when he planted a seed in her heart, and now it comes to a point where it can be watered and sprout and grow into something powerful for herself. When was the last time you have specifically prayed for a divine interaction, a divine appointment? Lord, bring me to somebody today. When we look at how it is that Jesus is saying that where I am, there my servant will be also. If you're truly following Christ, he will lead you where you need to be, because he is already there, working on the hearts and minds of people who need to hear from him. And he gives you, not just me, but you and you and you and you, the privilege of engaging in the work of the Holy Spirit in the salvation of somebody's life. And here's the thing to think about. If you want to keep your mouth shut, that's fine. All you're doing is giving your job to a rock. Because if we don't say something, the rocks will. Now, do you really want a rock to take your job? I didn't think so. Verse 27. Now my soul is troubled. For what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour? But for this purpose I came to this hour. For what? For what is this purpose? Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven saying, I have both glorified it and will glorify it again. Therefore the people who stood by and heard it said that it had thundered. Others said, an angel has spoken to him. Jesus answered and said, this voice did not come because of me, but for your sake. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be cast out. And I, if I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all peoples to myself. Do you remember when Jesus had made that same statement again earlier in the Gospel of John? Who was he talking to? He was talking to Nicodemus. What's he referring to when he's talking to Nicodemus? He's talking about the serpent that Moses lifted up, the bronze serpent. You know, the serpents that were biting all these people, and they fastened this bronze serpent and put it on a pole, a cross, if you will, and lifted it up. And all you had to do was look over in the direction of where that bronze serpent was, and you'd be healed from that snake bite. And that's what Jesus was referring to when he's talking to Nicodemus about this. But here, he's referring to it again. If I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw all peoples to myself. Now, this doesn't mean that every person will be drawn to him. It's a word meaning ethnos. It's a word that all people groups. I'll draw people from all walks of life unto myself. And what is it then that Jesus is referring to in that first statement of, now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour, but for this purpose I came to this hour. What was that purpose? But to be lifted up on the cross so that all peoples may be drawn unto him. That was the primary purpose for why he came. This he said, signifying by what death he would die. And the people answered him, we have heard from the law that the Christ remains forever. And how can you say the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is this Son of Man? Then Jesus said to them, a little while longer, the light is with you. Walk while you have the light, lest darkness overtake you. He who walks in darkness does not know where he is going. While you have the light, believe in the light, that you may become sons of light. These things Jesus spoke and departed and was hidden from them. So this gives us a little bit of an idea of the mindset of the people. Wait a minute. How you're supposed to be the king. You're supposed to be the Messiah. We're ready to take and crown you. Here you are. You're bringing this royal entry into Jerusalem. You're the Messiah. The Messiah. Our tradition tells us that Messiah is supposed to remain forever. But yet you're saying about being lifted up. Do you think they caught on to what he's talking about being lifted up? I think the context here tells us that they were catching on to what he's talking about. So this tells you also that there is this conflict between how they believed the Messiah would work versus how the Messiah was truly to work, what he was really going to do. They were thinking of a temporal victory. They were thinking of a victory from which they could have over the liberation of the Romans and not have to pay taxes and all that kind of stuff. I can keep more money in my pockets. That, what a grand thing that would be. How many of us would love to not have to pay taxes anymore? Every hand could go up, well, except for maybe Gabriel, because you don't pay taxes. I pay taxes for you. But at any rate, you know, I'm sure we would all love to not have to pay any more taxes. But is that really what Jesus is all about? I have come that you may not pay taxes and that you may enjoy more wealth. I have come that you may have a bigger house. I have come that you may have a free education. Ha ha ha. I have come what? That you may have life and have it more abundantly. He was not focusing on the temporal. He was focusing on the eternal. And that's what he wants us to focus on as well. Yes, we have to pay attention to the temporal and what is happening around us. But we plan for the eternal. We live within the temporal, but we plan for the eternal. It's nice to have a nice house here. I'm not saying that you shouldn't. It's nice to have a nice house here. But don't let that be your aim in life. The fine car, the fine clothes, the nice house. You cannot let these things become your focus in life, or they will consume you, because they will never be nice enough. Somebody once asked John D. Rockefeller, how much is enough money? And he was already a wealthy man at this point in time. How much is enough money? And he's reported to have said, just a few more dollars. So now, when does that actually happen? You get the few more, you want a few more. You get a few more, you want a few more. You get a few more, you want a few more. It never ends. And incidentally, he was miserable at that point in time in his life too. So Jesus is not here. He did not come so that we can have a grand existence here. But he came so that we may have eternal life. It is for this purpose that I have come into the world. It is for the purpose of him being nailed to the cross and lifted up for all to see. He takes our shame upon himself. These Greeks had come asking to see Jesus. It's very interesting that here we have these Greeks who come from the West at the end of Jesus' life, just like we had Magi who came from the East at the beginning of Jesus' life. But when living water flows, there is no stopping it. It will go east, west, north, south, wherever it is that you are willing to go. If you're allowing Christ to number your steps, you will be where he has already gone before you. And it's for the very purpose of proclaiming the cross and salvation so that somebody else can experience truly the grace and the mercy of God through the blood of Christ.
Oh, friends, we must keep our focus in life. We must keep our eyes on Christ and let him be our ultimate goal. To tell others about Jesus and the salvation he brings is the highest calling there is for mankind. Most of us don't really even know just how much of a Hosanna cry for help our lives proclaim. But when we do, and it comes to that point of recognition, we can certainly give a big Hosanna exclamation for that salvation that is found in Jesus, for having it come into our lives as we accept Christ as our Savior and know that he is the only way to God and the only way to true happiness. Nothing else will do, friends. There is nothing else in this world or in this life that will bring true and lasting joy outside of Christ in our hearts. If we chase after the nicest things that can be found and provided for on this planet, and set those things as our focus in life, then we will always come up disappointed, because those things can only ever bring a temporary satisfaction, which will always end up leaving us empty and wanting for something else. It is only in Christ that true purpose in life can be found. And a life for Christ means a life in service to others, in the same way that Christ lived to serve those around him and minister to their needs. The Bible actually has a little something to say about this. Note what is in the scriptures. Then a dispute arose among them as to which of them would be the greatest. And Jesus, perceiving the thought of their heart, took a little child and set him by him, and said to them, "Whoever receives this little child in my name receives me, and whoever receives me receives him who sent me. For he who is least among you all will be great." Now, first of all, friends, Jesus is not here saying that even the least of the followers of Christ will be great. Rather, one of the primary points that Jesus is making here is that true greatness is not found in being served, it is found in serving. But it is more than just serving in general. It is serving with a purpose. It is serving God and doing His will, and thus serving humanity in a way that brings honor to God and to those we are in contact with. The position that most of us find ourselves in that leads to that cry for help that most of us don't even know our lives are making is selfishness. We get too focused on our own wants and what we think we need, and we lose sight of the needs of others. And when we lose sight of that, we most certainly will not think of tending to those needs. We seek a kingdom of self rather than seeking the kingdom of God first, and trusting that when we do, that God will provide all of our true needs. Jesus gave us the greatest example of what it is to live a life of service when he said, "Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many." If God's character is to be outwardly focused and serve others, then how much more so should that be our focus in life as well? When our lives are going out of control and the circumstances we live in tend to send out that Hosanna cry for help, God hears us because he is focused on others rather than himself. If we are willing to accept that help that he brings to us, then we can give a Hosanna word of gratitude to God for what it is that he has provided. But what about when help doesn't come in quite the way we thought it should or would? Do we still shout Hosanna to God for the gift of help that he has given? Well, the simple answer is yes. A man by the name of Paul stated something very interesting many years ago when he wrote, "In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you." In everything give thanks. This includes the tough times as well as the good times. This includes when things are going rough as well as when they're running smooth. This, of course, isn't easy to do because we are more self-centered in our focus. And as a result, we look at how things are going. And most of the time, when things are not going quite how we would like them to go, then we become very tempted to think that God is not with us, or that he doesn't care, or perhaps that he even actually hates us. But this is not true. What is true is that bad things happen to good people for no other reason than because bad things simply happen. We cannot think that God brings these bad things upon us. Let no one say when he is tempted, "I am tempted by God." For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he himself tempt anyone. Not only does God not tempt anyone, but God also does not deliberately cause evil to fall upon someone unless they have willfully demonstrated that that is what they have really wanted all along. Rather, we live in a world that is cursed with sin, and the only hope we have is the return of Christ and the eradication of the sin problem. But until that happens, we need to recognize our need for Christ, the sacrifice that he has made on our behalf, and express our gratitude to Christ for making that sacrifice by accepting it for ourselves and claiming the blood of Christ for the forgiveness of our sins. If you would like to learn more about this, or if there is anything that you would like to have prayer about, then I invite you to reach out and contact us at the email that is at the bottom of this screen. And we will be happy to be a part of your walk with Christ and to encourage you along the way. Well, that is our time for today, friends. I look forward to seeing you again next time, but until then, remember what is in the scriptures: the stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone.
Thank you for joining us for In the Scriptures today. It has been our pleasure to have been a part of your day today. If there is anything that you would like to contact us about or a question that you have regarding anything that is covered on In the Scriptures, then I invite you to connect with us by sending us an email to contact@inthescriptures.com. That's contact@inthescriptures.com. We also have a free offer this month that comes to us from the ministry It Is Written and is titled, Why Does God Allow Suffering? If you would like your free copy of this study guide, then you can again use that same email address of contact@inthescriptures.com and let us know how to get your free copy of Why Does God Allow Suffering into your hands. Additionally, if you would like to receive a DVD copy of this program, then again, you can use that same email address of contact@inthescriptures.com and let us know where to send your DVD to. We look forward to hearing from you and engaging in an uplifting dialogue where we explore the scriptures together and, most importantly, where Christ is glorified. Once again, that email address is contact@inthescriptures.com. Thank you again for watching. Have a wonderful and Christ-centered day. Thank you.
Throughout the millennia, those that have explored what was unknown to them have made maps as a way of detailing where it is that they have been and as a guide to others that would follow afterwards. As populations grew, expansion and the need for maps also grew, and thus copycat maps were made and sold. As a way of curtailing forgeries, some map makers would insert fake towns into their maps and thus be able to spot a knockoff that contained those same fake towns. We use maps to figure out where we are and to know how to get where we are going. But the Bible tells us that if we seek the kingdom of God first, then God will provide all of our needs and that He will never leave us. He will give us the guidance that we need, and He knows right where we are all the time, both physically and spiritually, with no need for fake information. I'm Craig Fish, and let's remember to live every day according to what is in the Scriptures.